Sad.
All right, let's go. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the VS Gaming Leg 2 First Division game. Omnius Gaming take on Transverse Gaming. My name is Muzz, joined by the ever punctual Miles. You see what I did there?
Thank you.
You see what I did there?
Shut up. Let's talk
about it. All right, perfect. So, Miles, tonight we've got Omnius Gaming taking on Transverse Gaming. It should be an absolute humdinger of a first division game. Obviously, Omnius Gaming coming with the experience, coming with the lads who have played in this type of scene for a while, versus very much the underdogs of the first division right now, TSG. They came up from the leg one open division, came straight to leg two first division, or at least they finished third and they got promoted. I feel that should be, this is going to be a tough fixture for them tonight versus kind of more veterans of the game who have been around a lot longer. So I think it's going to be a tough quest to the top of the hill for TSG.
I think Omnius Gaming is probably one of the worst teams for Transverse Gaming to verse against, especially as the underdog, because I have a friend. He was in Omnius Gaming, he was part of the roster, but then he left the roster because he didn't feel like he was good enough. But I've seen them play. They're between Prime Division and First Division. So I feel like they're like one of the top teams in First Division. I feel like Transverse Gaming is going to have a really hard game ahead of them. Maybe just the stomp all the way, but hopefully not. I like enjoying two teams battling out for like 15 minutes or 30 minutes. But should we go into the bands?
Of course. So I think we enjoy letting those bands come through just so there's a bit more meat to talk about, you know. So on the Omnius Gaming side, we've got the Kotl, the Klinks, and the Pugna. Kotl, I think, very standard, good support right now, you know, with his Wisp. Good crowd control there, the chakra magic as well, decent in lane, whether you're going to be helping a core offlaner or a core safe laner, you know, getting that extra bit of mana buff is always good for you. Klinks right now as well got a buff to Searing Arrows, so small little buff there between his Searing Arrows whilst getting a bit more of the mana usage coming from him. So I would say good hero right now, almost edged to be a decent maybe pseudo support, position 5, submission 4. Could work out. And then of course Pugna, you know, very good magic damage, very good against kind of your tanky beefy heroes, you know, Timber Sword, DK, etc. So I'd say Omnius right now having banned out heroes that they probably do not want to play against with that crowd control, with that kind of long range mana harass, plus, you know, Klinks with that decent right click as well. Winter Wave in there again, good crowd control with the Winter's Curse, plus he's got a heal, plus he's got that lane push presence with a Splinter Blast. Miles, if you want to take the TSG bans, you're welcome.
Meepo ban, I always ban Meepo in my rank game because, like, if it's a cheese hero, especially in this really push heavy meta, it's just disgusting. I think Omnius Gaming, they have the skills to play Meepo, but I'm not too sure. I didn't really do my research on them. Don't really care enough. But I want to talk about this Pugna ban. So Pugna, I think they mostly banned for pause 4. Like, you saw against with OG's Sumaya, like Saxa played a really good pause for Pugna, and that Pugna literally won the game because that Nether Ward's basically like a Will-O-Wisp, basically like a Supernova. You have to hit the Nether Ward, or else it's just going to destroy your team. And then, like, the Kirby is just amazing. Like, Pugna is just such a great pause for.
Yeah, so now on our picks here, Miles, on the pitch, we've got a Jakiro with a Warlock here from the TSG side, and from the OG side, we've got Rubick and a Beastmaster. Obviously, all four of these heroes great in their own rights. I'll tackle TSG here if that's fine. Very good sustaining lane supports that they've picked up here in a Warlock and a Jakiro as well. Heals on the Warlock here with a great ultimate for push potential. The push potential on Jackie as well is fantastic. You've got a very good stun in that ice wall, plus a push from your E and then your dual breath as well. Decent harass into Macropyre, which is a very awesome damage over time ultimate. Undying here with the tombstone and the decay, so potential to harass in the lane coming at you from TSG is pretty decent. So for all of these heroes, that they've drafted right now, decent lane presence, good harass. You've got Shadow Word DK with the Dual Breath as well, is pretty decent. And then the Liquid, I think it's called Liquid Burn or something like that. So I'd say TSG have opened up with a decent flex picks, decent heals, good abilities, good catch, good harass. You know, Tombstone in a team fight will be advantageous to TSG because you have to knock it down first before you take them on. So yeah, I like what TSG have put out so far.
I agree with you. TSG, they're really focusing on team fighting and laning stage. Like, all these three heroes are really good at laning stage, except for maybe Warlock. But Undying and Draco are definitely really good at laning stage. And in team fight, they're just really... Like, if you put down a good Ice Pop, that can win you the fight. If you put down a good Tombstone in the right position, teams are going to have a hard time hitting it. And then, before you know it, you have like five zombies on you, and then the core just counts on you. But going to the Omnius Gaming, the Beast Monster pick, I love Beast Monster as an offlaner. I think he's a really good dominator. If played in a pro's hand, he can 1v2 any lane, and he can allow his possible to just freely roam without being worried about the enemy safe laner getting fed off his offlaner. So I think Beast Monster is just a great mid-game pick, great laner. But more interesting is this silencer. I don't know where the silencer is going to go. Probably a pause for silencer, because unless they want to pick the mid right now, but I don't really see why they need to pick the mid. I mean, silencer is good against like if you want to engage, so you definitely want to combo the silencer ulti with the beast monster roll, like maybe smoke with the seed, beast monster roll, then instantly global silence, and then you can get a pick up on the core without like the support reacting.
Yeah, I mean, I think that silence is going to be a great position for. Obviously, Beastmaster, I think, is opening up to be in a position 3 already. I think OG obviously would like to have that Beastmaster on their team, so they've just sacrificed the first pick reveal just to get to have it guaranteed so that they have it, which is fine. Silencer, possibly a mid, but more than likely your position 5 or 4 here, depending on where that Rubick's going to go. But Rubick would be nice to use, like a telekinesis lift back into a Beastmaster would be pretty great. And of course, silencing your lane, you've got your glaives, which can do a lot of damage. So, for example, it should then be silence against the Slark, which would be pretty good. He can obviously, you're not going to be able to get off too many abilities when he's got you silenced. And then the Primal Roar later on is going to do a lot of damage and pushback. And I think your silencer coupled with your Beastmaster does a lot of damage against a Tombstone and also a Golem. So definitely early picks coming up from OG here, looking pretty great against TSG's lineup. You know, got that Golem defense sorted, should have that Tombstone defense sorted if they're not silenced already. But that Slark, Miles, I think, yeah, lots of...
I mean,
of,
TSG just have so many stuns and so many slows for that Slark to be able to get on the Rubick and on the silencer and just get like 6 agi stacks before running away. And then Radiant, like, even with the... With the Leshrac pick, I think that's a mid Leshrac. That's really uncommon. I haven't seen a Leshrac being picked in forever. It's just like no one knows how to play it in my bracket, and it's really bad in my brackets. I don't know.
But I mean, Leshrac obviously did get a buff to his damage recently as well, which is more of a core Leshrac buff than what a support Leshrac buff would be. And I mean, from what I can see right now, I think this is a core Leshrac. So I'd say that's fine. I mean, in the recent patch, you did get the buff, Miles, so I think that's okay. Almost going to be a mid Leshrac here, I would say.
So OG Gaming have really good pushing potential, and something that's not commonly known that Leshrac does counter Slark, because his Pulse Nova and his Diabolic Edict goes through Slark's Dark Pack. So even if you Dark Pack on no HP, this Pulse Nova can still kill you. So who's playing Slark? Visions. So I think Visions will have to be very careful about how he handles his HP against the Leshrac, because the Leshrac can kill the Slark early to mid game.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's got quite he had a decent small buff now recently, which kind of added to your core Leshrac, which I think is going to be great. If we check out the further bans on the TSG Dire side, there's going to be Meepo, Leshrac now, and Ursa. Sorry, Lifestealer. Meepo, Lifestealer, and Ursa. Well, I think those are all pretty great against the Tombstone. When you're looking at Lifestealer and you talk about kind of nerfing the beefiness to Undyne's ulti, it's great, plus Ursa attacking that Tombstone as well. Obviously, great, you know, bans towards the Golem as well. So, you know, so you don't bring that down so quickly. And then, of course, Mars on the other side. 5 seconds. I guess because they have the offlane and the Beastmaster, and maybe they suspect that TSG do not have kind of a core offlaner yet. Just because of kind of the flex of what you get with like a Warlock and Undying, they probably just banned the Muzz out in case. They're not sure if it's going to be like a kind of core mid slash three position, so they banned it out anyway. Dire team pick. And then plus the TA. Alright.
So Omnius Gaming, I think they want to probably go for... I would like maybe a Naga. Because Naga can solo lane by herself. And against the... against... who's their offlaner? Undying? Like against the Undying, the Kiro offlane, you don't have to stay in the lane because you have Mirror Image in Monster lane. Pick. Bloodseeker. Oh, shit. Got the prediction wrong. Bloodseeker, I feel like Bloodseeker's gonna have a really hard time in lane against the Liquid Fire from Jakiro and just the Decay from Undying, but Undying like wrecks any core laning state, but I guess the Bloodseeker's to have is another counter to the slot, but I would rather prefer a Naga or a PR, someone that can farm jungle earlier than most cores can.
I think maybe like in TSG's haste here to kind of ban out heroes for their tombstone remaining. And the golem, like in Ursa for example, that did leave the Bloodseeker completely wide open in the pool, which is obviously a big counter to the Slark. And OG are taking advantage of that. Plus he's got silence with his AoE, you know, he's got the rupture as well, which is great. Bloodseeker pretty standard counter to the Slark, which obviously TSG kind of left wide open now. You know, this happens, so it's okay. But should be a mid-Kunkka build coming at you from an outsider. So he's going to go up against a Leshrac. I don't know, Miles, have you seen a lot of Kunkka versus Leshrac? What's the deal there?
No, but Kunkka normally should win the lane just because Leshrac is... he does not have a lot of HP, he does not have a lot of armor or right-click damage to out-tank the... Kunkka's Tidebringer or the his 5 HP. Seconds remaining. But it should be Kunkka fed, but knowing Omnius Gaming picking up 626, 626 probably knows how to win the lane because he has more experience. He has a higher understanding of the game, so I'm really interested in this mid lane to see if this Leshrac can beat this Kunkka mid laning stage.
Alright, so do you have a favorite right now? Do you have kind of a draft that you find is superior to the other one right now?
I think this is like when TSG versed... who did they verse? Did they verse Soul Gaming? What was that team that they versed?
I can't remember. NPG or Nobodies or...
Nobodies, yeah. It was when they versed Nobody. They had the better draft. I like their timings better, TSG's timings better, but the overall experience from Nobodies and also Omnius Gaming, I think they're going to have the upper edge of it. So I'm going to go Omnius Gaming. It's probably 2-0. Probably Omnius going to be 2-0.
Being as optimistic as usual, Miles, that's what we love about you.
Thank you. Just keeping it real here, boys.
That's what we absolutely love about you. Okay, well, guys, this is going to be Omnius Gaming taken on Transverse Gaming in a first division game. This is leg two. So Transverse Gaming find themselves promoted from the open division up until the first division. I think a lot of first division teams kind of want to try beat down the newcomers, show them that it's not easy to play at this level. And you know what, rightly so, it shouldn't be easy playing at this level. So we're all going to see what Omnius Gamer are going to have to do to TSG tonight. Are they going to maybe give them a bit of a spanking, you know, just to say like, hey, you know, you got to work hard to be at this level. I think we're going to see, Miles, it should be a good game ahead of us.
Well, hopefully it's a good game, not just a stomp, because it is Omnius Gaming. Average ranks like Divine, I think.
Well, I don't know. You'd have to look. Don't quote stuff you're not sure of here, friend.
I know 626 is Divine, and I know Spooked is Ancient 5 or Divine 1. I'm not too sure. But I know that Omnius Gaming have really decent ranked players on their team, but Divine's against Guardians. It's a bit of a stomp, but hopefully Transverse Gaming, they play better as a team than they do solo, so hopefully they can show us something. The battle begins. Talking about the lane, bottom lane Vision is with Warlock. against the Beastmaster. It should be fine. I'm surprised that this No, actually, I like the switch between the Silencer not going bot, because if the Silencer and Beastmaster both went bot, and Silencer started with Arcane Curse on the Slark, after Slark gets his Dark Pact, the Silencer is just rendered quite useless in lane. But even still, I still would have... it's actually fine.
I mean, yeah, Shadow's able to provide a lot of sustain in the lane. It's pretty good. He's got his Shadow Word first as well, so he can either do damage to the Ominous boys, they're unique and spooked, or, you know, always going to be able to heal up visions. Plus, I'm sure he'll go for Fatal Bond second, do a bit of damage. He really doesn't need that upheaval right now. You know, there's no one really to slow in team fights as of yet. I think he might even go for upheaval quite last, almost maybe level 5 before he's 6, which
he
is really fine.
Want to max out the Shadow Word as a Warlock.
Yeah.
It's like, all his other spells are really trash. Upheaval is so fucking long. Like, Fatal Bonds, your team doesn't have enough damage early game to make Fatal Bonds worth it. So Shadow Words is like your only option. So I would like to see Shadow max out Shadow Word and just puts it on the boar, because the boar is a key aspect to the Beast Monster winning his lane. Because as soon as he gets two boars, you can't go into lane. Because if you go up to lead, you hit by two boars and then you get right click. And then you have to run away because the slow is just ridiculous.
Yeah, and Sneaky having quite a good time as a position 5. He's able to harass Wiseman and Frangia in the lane with the silence,
blood,
yeah. There might be first blood here coming onto the Jakira. Oh, he's going to miss. But I mean, you know, this is like such a great position 5 because he's harassing as well as what a position 4 would do. And he's just trying to keep Frag and Wiseman out of this lane. You already, Frag has to run in the tower, find the creeps out there. But I mean, Wiseman as well had a TP back because he was on the wrong side of the tracks there. So Sneaky Snake having quite a decent, very early 1 minute so far. You know, he's got that headdress up as well, so he can give a bit of mana HP regen here to Whitewind. But I think,
so,
I mean,
I like that Sneaky started with Arcane Curse level 1, because as we all know, Undying and Jakiro spam heavy heroes. This Undying is gonna spam like 5 DKs on you before the 2 minute mark, and that's why you start with Arcane Curse. I like that he didn't start with Blaze of Wisdom, because that's normally what normal pass 4 pass 5 is. But he, Sneaky, adapt as a good player, adapting to the lane, knowing that these two heroes are very spam heavy, start with the Arcane Curse, because as soon as you put the Arcane Curse on, like, Frag, he wants to put down the Tombstone and the Decay, but he's gonna take so much damage from this Arcane Curse.
And yeah, 6-6 picking off the outsider. There was a Torrent throwing, just trying to catch the Leshrac off. It wasn't enough, and yeah, he went down there. All right, geez, they've fallen. TSG men falling on all sides right now. Top lane and bottom lane going down here, respectively. So that's really 3-0 going to Ominous Gaming. Starting with 6-6 here in the mid lane.
That's already such a disaster. You lost your Kunkka mid against, which was supposed to be a favorite lane for you, and then you lost the bot lane. I think Shadow's gonna die? No. The boss.
Depends if Unique does come through with a Fade Bolt. He's got it on cooldown, but I mean, he could very easily take Shadow down here. You can just see these lanes here from Ominous Gaming, and they're all starting with a headdress because they know that HP regen is quite vital to them at the moment. So, I mean, you know, the Silencer and both the Beastmaster have got an early headdress, which is great.
I mean, I think mid lane outside is going to die again.
We can check.
Oh,
yeah.
Lord,
right, there he goes down. I mean, that's what I was telling you about. Like, Leshrac picked up that extra buff in damage as a core Leshrac. So, I mean, he's, you know, flaunting it right now.
I think he's only got buffed to his ulti.
Oh well, I guess either way.
Yeah, I think this just shows that 6-6, just like the difference between 4 experience.
Radiant's middle tower,
like,
is
even
for
this is a Kunkka favorite matchup, 6-6 obviously has the experience, obviously has the skills to know how to counter act this outsider. This is not really what you want as a Kunkka, because you want to be dominating the lane and then helping your core, creating space.
So, I mean, who's got like the better stunner disabled? Because it's split Earth versus a Torrent. So, I mean, there you see the Torrent right now on 6-6. Obviously, he's been using split Earth to great effect. What's better? What would you rather have in lane, Torrent or a split Earth?
I think both things are shit on themselves, but Torrenting with X marks the spot is more superior than the slow from 6-6.
Top lane, Sneaky Snake might go down here. He's looking very, very low. Should be one more hitcher coming up from the Jakiro. Oh, he's
I'm surprised
on next to nothing. He's gonna steal the bounces as well. Throws out a silence. Oh yeah, Wiseman might just go down now as well. White Wind. Oh goodness.
Wiseman should have missed dual breath. He had opportunity here to dual breath. Sneaky Snake, and he had that opportunity where Sneaky Snake was up here and he was here to dual breath. I spammed Jakiro from Ancient 2 to Ancient 5, so I know exactly how to play this hero. But even there, when he was running away, the Sneaky came back, and like, if you're support and you're about to die, don't run away. Just go deal out all your abilities, go deal some damage to the other enemy team, and then you can die, because running away is useless. But if you can kill the Silence or even take like 200 HP off this White Wind, it's worth it for your death.
Well, I mean, to be honest, I think Sneaky Snake was very fortunate surviving there. He easily left with only about like 5% or 4% health. Yeah, Wiseman, if he did have a dual breath, I didn't see that for myself, but I mean, that was very close. Yeah, and unfortunately, he fell instead of Sneaky Snake, because that Silencer definitely should have died there in the lane, or at least in the triangle. So, you know, pity for on TSG not picking up the kill and Omnius, but it's fine. And check your Beastmaster, just get in those sneaky little wards. Going in into the jungle. Exactly what he should be doing with his creeps.
Helm of the Dominator.
Yeah, Helm of the Dom, yeah.
I mean, I don't know how Vision goes up. If he goes up into the lane, he gets halberd smash, and then they can dive this tower right now.
Yeah, they could. I mean, he's got so many creeps in him right now. There we go. He's going to go down to Fade Bolt. They're looking at turning attention onto Shadow. Should be able to go down as well. There's going to be no Fade Bolt, but the man should be able to die nonetheless. Oh, and that Hellbear does the work. Mid lane, yeah, there's a gang from Wiseman. They're going into 6-6. Should they be able to turn them? There's going to be an Earth Split. Here comes Unique. Oh, okay. Ghost Ship coming in. This ladder and Unique brings them way down, but it's not enough to kill both of them.
You're a trusty. If Wiseman waited for outside to get level 6, the kill would have been so easy, but they just... Kunkka was one creep away from level 6, and they still went on to the left side. Like, why are you in such a rush? Just wait for the Kunkka to get one creep. It's one creep. It's like, not that hard. Just wait for them to get one creep. Then you can combo the X mark with the boats and torrents, and then you can get that left side kill. But now, you've wasted so much time off this Jakiro, and you didn't even get the kill.
Yeah, now bottom lane, it looks like Vision's having quite a tough time against this Beastmaster and all his minions. I mean, he's got the freaking Hellbears out, he's got the Boars out as well. There's so much push potential here on a Beastmaster. He actually doesn't need Unique in the lane right now, throws out the Primal Roar. Yeah, like the thing is, he's literally solo in this lane by himself. He's going to pick up a double kill if he takes down Wiseman here. He's Hellborn. Oh, goodness. Radiant's middle tower has fallen. So he's having a blast right now in the lane.
This GG already. There's no point in playing this game. Just transfer this game and just call it to reset. Like, your mid lane got stomped. This Flash Strike's gonna push with this Beastmaster, and this Beastmaster just stomped the lane.
No way, man. Miles, at least like find the middle ground, dude. You can't just be like that right now. Don't be that negative Sally here, please.
I mean, it's so hard. Like, Vision's is level 4 and his Beastmaster is level 7. He can't even farm this bottom jungle part because his Spookid is just farming that place. And I don't know.
Yeah, that's the thing. So Spook obviously did have quite a decent lane with all those minions of his as well. Plus, he's got the Helm of the Dom. So, I mean, check how many neutral creeps he gets to cruise around with. He's got 5 to his name right now, which he can go around with, which means he's got so much extra push potential. White Wind top lane, he's going to be able to TP out. He's going to get out. Oh, the ice path from Wiseman didn't come out. Could have stopped at TP, and now Sneaky Snake, he's trying to get away. He's going to TP as well. Outsider can't catch him. So it's 10 kills to 0 right now with a 9k net worth lead, Miles.
I mean, TSG rotated 4 top, and their Undying died, and no one died on the opponent's side, I think. But meanwhile, 6-2-6 and the Beastmaster are pressuring bot lane, forcing more rotation. It's just really hard to see how TSG pulls up.
So, I mean, what do you need right now? You need to, like, turtle and kind of just farm and make sure that you've got, like, this whole side of your jungle watered up so you can farm safely. Here we go. Frag jumping in at 66. Earth Split is going to get dropped. His Vision will be able to jump on him, but he's got these ancient golems stopping him.
Oh, I don't... If Omnus Gaming plays it right, this Beastmaster should be in this jungle. with a Rubick, and this Leshrac should be in this jungle, pushing this tier one tower. And then as soon as Omnius Gaming does that, there's no way TSG can come back in this game, because you can't farm the creep waves. Because if you shut up the creep waves, you get ganked, you get rolled, and you die. If you go up to the jungle or your own jungle, this Leshrac and Beast Monster is going to be there, and you can't really fight against them right now. So, and then Omnius Gaming definitely have to get really cocky and go dive a tower or like tier or high ground or something.
Well, I mean, they are pushing the top tower between your Sneaky Snake and White Wind. They're pushing the top tier tower. They've got a Siege Creep as well. It's undefended. So, I mean, sure, they've been as cocky members as they can. Mid lane, maybe potential brawler. There is Tombstone on Frag. He's sitting without his ulti for now, which is going to be quite detrimental in the team fights. Primal Blow coming at you from Spook. There catches Frag. Should be able to take him down quite quickly. Oh, he drops the Tombstone there just on the fringes. Not going to be enough. Now the high ground though, 6-6. Trying to jump on outsider.
So much damage.
Oh, yeah, here comes Whitewind, throws on the Blood Rite. He gets the Rupture onto Wiseman. Should be quite an easy kill. Throws the Ice Pot. He should be able to take him down. Killing sprees all around right now. Turn the attention here to Shadow. He's going to dive the tower. Should be quite easy as well. Fade Bolt coming on from Unique. Picks up the last kill there. Mid tower's down as well. They're probably going to push the tier 2.
Yeah, so this is what happens when Beast Monster gets farmed. Like, this Beast Monster, he can 1v4 the whole team right now.
Yeah, it's pretty big.
The Necro Book just does so much damage, and then it's aura. He didn't even take any levels in Cactus, and why do you? If you're so far ahead, just take max your board. Like, really hard for TSG Gaming. Like, Slug Vision doesn't even have his boots. Outsider doesn't even have his boots. It's just, I don't know.
Okay, so Miles, let's then do a quick breakdown of this game. Maybe we've got a bit of free time on our hands here. What exactly do you think just contributed to the Omnius Gaming kind of steamroll? Was it an offlaner that can summon a lot of minions like this Beastmaster is able to push the lane? Was that very good against the likes of a Slark and a Warlock? Were they unable to maybe keep down three or four different neutral creeps when it comes to a push? What do you suspect happened there?
So firstly, it's just rank difference. Like, honestly, like, if I was midding, I'm not even a mid player, I'm a support player. If I'm a Ancient Five support, I'm not a mid lane player. But if I go against a legend five mid lane, I would destroy him. It's just that I have a more understanding of the lane and my matchup and how to play the game than a legend five does. And that's exactly how this is going. Transport Gaming, there's a bit of newbies, you know, Guardians, Crusaders, and then on the side of Omnius Gaming, they're like the Vine. They know how to play the game. They know what exactly how strong their timings are, how to win the lane matchup. So it's mostly just rank difference and just skill difference. And also Warlock is just a really bad pause fight right now. Like, if I picked a Warlock as pause fight in my rank game, I'll probably get reported by four guys in my team.
No, rubbish.
He's just so bad.
No, rubbish. He's a good... You know what? Tell me one thing that's bad about a Warlock, dude. He's got sustain in the lane. He's got a great push and ultimate. He's got a semi-stun with an ultimate as well. As kind of a slow with the upheaval. What is bad about a Warlock?
The thing is that those abilities are good, but there's just under support that can do so much more. Like, a Kotal. Like, we all agree that a Kotal. Okay, which one do you think is better, Kotal or a Warlock? Like, in this meta right now, like, which one have you been seeing more of a thing?
I'll tell you now, as Omnius Gaming take a huge fight, get a triple kill onto Spook. Does it take four down? They're looking for Shadow. They should be able to pick up five here as well. He goes down. Oh, Spook picks up the ultra kill. So they're going to push the tier 3 tower now in under 15 minutes. Things looking pretty good for OG as it stands. And I think it was definitely that experience in the league we've alluded to earlier. You know, that's like a loaded question, Miles, because yes, Kotal is being picked up more in the meta right now. So, I mean, what must I say? Kotal is favored over Warlock just because of that?
The thing is that, so back a few patches ago, CM was really good, right? Like, he was S tier. A lot of Dota, Alchemy, Game League, all these guys were talking about how good CM was, but now they all put her down in like a D tier rank. So now all the S tier are like Snapfire. All the Snapfires are like...
Oh yeah, Vision's jumping onto 6-2-6 again, been enough. Blood Rocket and throwing down my Windwind. Okay, Ice Puff catches one.
Like Snapfire over someone over Warlock is that Snapfire counters more people than Warlock. Warlock doesn't really counter a lot of meta heroes. Like he can't really deal with this put. Like he dropped the Warlock ulti. Okay, fine. But like if a Carter drops his ulti, you have to force his entire team to hit that thing because it still disrupts it. Oh no, vision.
This primal roar coming at you from Spooks is doing a hell of a good job right now at the moment. Bloodrake getting thrown down there by White Wind. He's looking for more. He's going into Fracture. Up! Stopped by the Ice Path. Very lucky there. Wiseman save. Yule's here onto 66.
I think it's not really. This game isn't really TSG's fault. They were just matched against a really unfavored matchup. It's like a 200 hour CSGO player playing against a pro player. It's like really hard. Like, I think TSG just. They just. Don't take this game too much into mind because this is a really unfavored matchup for you guys. But just keep playing Dota, keep grinding the rank. And then the more you grind the rank, the more knowledge you can gain of the game. And the more you can learn to deal with different heroes and things. So it's just more about playing the game. It's not really about draft wise or anything, but it's mostly about skill wise and knowledge of just the overall game.
How much stock do you put into a team playing together versus grind and rank? Because, you know, sure, it's probably all good and well if a team can grind rank and every player gets like Archon 1. But how much stock do you put in that team actually playing together and having time together versus them grinding rank?
I think...
Because obviously there's a big difference though.
I was part of a team, as you know, Muzz, but I was widely outranking the other guys, and it's impossible to play rank game because I have a different perception of the game than my teammates, and when I tell them to do something, they have a different perception of it because their things aren't working in their bracket and my things aren't working in my bracket. But the main thing is that the more you play rank, the better players you get, the more pulling you get. Like in lower rank game, the sport might not pull, but in higher rank game, they pull like all the time. They do like weird ass pulls that really destroy the lane.
Weird ass pull. No, I hear you. I mean, I get that. I just want to know, is there like a difference between how much time you can spend doing solo rank versus how much time you need to actually spend on your teamwork to create that synergy and chemistry? I feel like it's probably a 50-50, Miles, or maybe a 60-40, if that.
I think it's more of a 60-40, as you say. I think teamwork is important, but if you're all playing at the same bracket and you're not really improving, you're not really meeting new opponents, you're not really improving the game. It just depends on, I would never start a team unless I know that I was very capable at the game, because as soon as you're capable at the game and you don't have to spend so much time understanding, wait, where did I go wrong, you can work on that team chemistry. So I think firstly, solo grind some ranks, gain some knowledge and some experience, and then play as a team. I think that's the best way.
Yes, so thick I'm choking on it.
Well, yeah, TSG definitely holding in as best they can. They're not throwing out the GG just yet. They're giving it the good old college try at the end. Yeah, lots of buybacks coming up for them as well. But Unique Spooky, his men are having such a crack of a time. So there we go. GG, Ominous Gaming, take game number one. And I think just... it was a case of kind of the better experienced team did play kind of the newer greenhorn team of the first division. No one said it's going to be easy. You are going to expect to kind of get a beaten like this. 31-3, Miles, it kind of does say enough. I don't know if you want to give a little bit of a post analysis right now. I feel like we maybe spent the last 10 minutes doing that, so it's up to you. You know, I'm not going to say it was a close game. I think it was quite a hectic game right now. So
there's nothing that TSG can do. Like, whatever outsider does in the mid lane, 626 is three steps ahead of him because he has that experience playing mid. But like, if I was TSG, I wouldn't blame my teammates. I wouldn't blame myself too hard for this. It's just an unfair matchup, just a complete storm.
Yep.
Like, it's really hard to watch this replay and get something from it. Because maybe they don't, like right now in TSG, they don't maybe understand some of the concepts that Omnius Gaming are applying in their laning state that wins them the game. Because they might be too complex of a thing, or they've never experienced it in their normal matchmaking. So for this last game, probably definitely last game. I think I just want Transfer Gaming to play the most comfortable hero. Like, don't try to outdraft them, because I like Transfer Gaming's draft. I like them overall, but Omnius Gaming won at the end of the day. So I wouldn't, like, as TSG over the next game, I wouldn't outdraft them. I'll just play my most comfortable hero and just have fun, because you're gonna lose. You're gonna get stomped. It's just how the match is gonna go. Nothing you can do about it, fortunately.
All right, guys. Well, that was Omnius Gaming taking game number one in this potential best of three series. Let's see what is going to happen after a very short break as we get the lobbies back up. Don't go anywhere. We'll see you soon. All right, and we're back. Game number two, Omnius Gaming taking on TSG Heralds. My name's Muzz, joined by the effervescent and always punctual Miles. Miles, game number two, what's good, man?
Dire team back. I'm excited because in the next 18 minutes, I'm going to go on this game is going to win. I'm going to go play some Dota.
All right, it's always good to know that you're so unbiased with these things. It's lovely.
Thank you.
All right, so we did see Spooked brought out an amazing Beastmaster this last game. He had so much push potential. He definitely kept Visions and Shadow down. That Slark with that... I can't remember all the names. Yes, thank you. The Slark with the Warlock there struggled, I think, against Unique and Spook. They had such an amazing offlane. And I think, obviously, 6-6 is Leshrac. He obviously did pretty well against Outsiders Kunkka there as well. But it's fine. You know, strong team like Omnius, we spoke about them already. They're going to do well when it comes to this division, especially against new guys that have just arrived on the scene, which is fine. You know, these replays are available. TSG can watch these games. They can see they went wrong. So, Beastmaster respect ban already. They're not looking to pick it for themselves. You know, maybe we don't know if Frag plays a good Beastmaster himself. We're never going to find out tonight. So we're going to let that go past. But OG, Miles, banned out the Kotl, the Snap, and the Underlord. Very strong heroes right now. Obviously, Kotl, you already were mentioned in the first game if you wanted a Kotl or a Warlock. Kotl been banned. Super meta. Snapfire, obviously super well. There's the Ursa. Super good right now as well. So kind of Omnius Gaming just trying to get out all of these S tier meta heroes that they know TSG would more than likely be able to pick up. So very decent bans coming out from their side.
Looking at the ban from Omnius Gaming, those four heroes are really strong in the lane. But Disruptor, I haven't seen much of Disruptor. Anything so, but since that Transverse Gaming, I think they were the ones who banned the Muzz. Or was it Omnius Gaming? I don't know, but one of these teams banned the Muzz last game because Muzz is just a really good offlaner. And I think Muzz in the hands of Spook is going to dominate Visions and Shadow 101 again. So I think Visions, he needs to pick like a Lifestealer or something. Lifestealer. Pion team pick against the Smaz. Viper midler. Viper plus four.
Yeah, it depends, maybe. Right? I mean, that Viper right now is pretty flex. Could be a mid, could be an offlaner, maybe even a cheeky support. Especially in the offlane against the Smaz, is gonna work.
Break.
Of course. So you got the Nether Toxin for a break. Spooked, if he plays that Beastmaster like he plays this Muzz, is going to have a good game. It looks like Unique going for that Rubick again. If it doesn't itch, you don't scratch it. And I think OG also know this. I think if you've noticed, TSG like to swap up their drafts. They choose different heroes versus, like, you know, if something works and we do well in it, then hell, play it five games in a row. It actually doesn't matter. And
like,
so
if you win the game for it, like, who cares?
Yeah. So the thing is, Unique might not be playing this Rubick, but there's probably a very good chance he is. And that's fine. OG are kind of in the position where they understand that this is our strength heroes. I can play it the whole time. I do really well on this hero. They're going to play it. And so Unique might just pick up this Rubick again versus now TSG already picking up a Lich. It's different. They're picking up a Viper, which is different.
10 seconds remaining.
And, you know, OG might even have picked that Beastmaster if it was not banned. You know, we can now never know. So the thing is, that's just the difference. I think it's a little bit of experience in the game. That's all. They've got a bit of skin in the game. They've been here for a long time and they know what to do. That's it.
From the side of TSG, I wouldn't, like I said, I wouldn't worry too much against counter picking. I'll just pick your comfort hero, because whatever you're gonna pick, Omnius Gaming are gonna dominate. Anyway, just have fun, play your most comfortable hero, and then watch the replay. Because if If Outsider plays his Invoker, which I think he's the most comfortable with, and he gets wrecked, he can look at that replay and say, oh, I thought my Invoker was pretty good, but these are some things I can improve on. I could really, you know, rotate at this time. So I'll just play my most comfortable heroes. If I was TSG and then Omnus Gaming, they can just pick like standard draws. It doesn't really matter what they pick.
I think, like, you know, at this point, you must just go back to your basics and maybe pick things that are comfortable. So, you know, play that draft that you really like, that you smash your pubs with, whatever it is, your ogre shamans, whatever the case might be, play them, stick to basics.
That's how OG plays the game. Like, they don't counter pick, or they rarely do, but they play. The other teams counter them. They play to what they want. They don't want fun.
I think those guys are also so good, man, Miles. Those guys are also so good that they play whatever they want. You know, it's kind of...
When you get to that skill level, I think mechanical skills, learning knowledge doesn't really matter. It's more about the pressure and the mentality of the game. It happens with a lot of our esports, top esports team. Like, it's more about the mentality and the...
Those guys are doing pretty much everything by second nature. They don't have to, like, think about a pool. They don't have to think about last hits, and they don't have to think about when to rotate or gank. It's very kind of second nature for them. Because, you know, they might be top immortal hundreds. It's very kind of standard for them. But Silencer coming out again here on the OG side. So that just kind of maybe reinforces what we were saying. So if Sneaky Snack wants to play this Silencer with Unique on the Rubrik again, OG understand that they're going to play the same heroes. They're going to win with these heroes. They don't care if they go through 10 drafts with the same heroes if it does what it needs them to do. Witch Doctor getting picked up here by TSG with a Luna. Now this is interesting. When last did you see a Luna potentially come out as a core?
Not often. She just she needs so many items to come online. Like, she's like an anti-mage, but anti-mage farms faster. Anti-mage is mobile. She's not. She can fight, but she's not like a troll. Troll can come online with one diffuser blade and one SNY. But Luna, if you get a Manta and then you get like a SNY, you still can't fight. You're really weak. You need like 3 items on the hero to be useful. So, Transverse Gaming, the mid is, that's probably a possible Viper Radiant against the mod, which is why maybe Sneaky Snake picked Silencer into the spam heavy hero. Again, he's probably going to start with Arcane Curse.
But I mean, Viper can't be... I don't think that Viper can be position 4 right now because TSG very clearly have a Witch Doctor and a Lich. Which means that Viper and that Luna are both cores. I wouldn't even want to say that the Luna is a position 4, because it's probably not. So that Viper is going to be maybe your offlaner right now, with Luna being your carry. So they're still going to look for a mid hero for Outsider. TA is in the pool. You spoke about Invoker earlier. Remember, so you're up against a Silencer. You're probably not going to pick... You won't pick a Quap. You won't pick a Storm. Probably not even an Ember game. You want to be able to get those abilities off without getting hurt by the Silencer. They've banned the Troll and the Monkey, which is great because it looks like OG still need a safe lane carry. Although this could be a crit shaker with like a mid Silencer. We never know. Dire
team pick. Omnus Gaming, they can pick up a Juggernaut, I think. Jesus. Monster.
Nice quick cooldown carries in a Morphlin.
TSG, I don't know what they're gonna pick. They can pick DK mid. They can pick not DK mid against Morphlin, never mind.
The thing is, you don't know what's gonna go mid right now. It's probably gonna be a mid Silencer because that Morph has to carry.
I don't know.
5 seconds remaining.
Like, all of this game, they can play. They can play Earthshaker mid if they want. I think it's still dumb.
They really could, but I don't think they will. I think Silencer now is prime just to be the mid hero after the Morphlin.
I think maybe TSG just picks up a DP. Like, really, it's good standard hero, really good push.
Okay, so there's that Invoker that you actually brought up earlier, Miles.
Yeah, I like seeing the Outsider playing his comfort hero.
It's usually TA, but I don't think he's feeling a TA in these games. So there we go. Sneaky Snack still Okay, so mid Rubick.
Look at that Viper.
How's this whole lineup from OG? You got a mid Rubick, Sneaker Snacks on the silencer, a carry. It looks like it's a carry Earthshaker, and it looks
carry
like it's
yeah,
and it looks like a position for Morphlin, dude. So yeah, I don't know. OG taking the piss right now. They want to win this game. They spoofing around a bit, I guess.
I think they're just having fun.
Yeah.
I think this is the most important part of winning Dota. Like, if you have fun with your five, with your other teammates, and you, even if you lose, you'd be like, oh my god, you missed the stun. Oh lord, you lost. Like, it's a joking manner, but it makes the game so much fun, and there's, like, no pressure on you at all to perform.
Okay,
play.
But I mean, work out this hypothetical with me, Miles. What if TSG actually win this game 2-0 just because of this OG draft?
Prepare
and then they happen to win game 3 and OG had to lose this whole series. Wouldn't that be pretty bleak, man, with the second game drafting right now?
I think if TSG hypothetically was going to win this game and then win the series overall, it's going to really... on this game is really going to feel bad about their confidence is going to get destroyed, and the confidence of
well not so much that their confidence will get bashed. I think their confidence will be fine. I think it comes down to like less of these type of spoofy drafts right now because they're trying to maybe take the piss. So like, it's fine. We definitely understand that OG have the confidence to play this lineup. You know, White Wind is going to play a carry. We spoke about Crit Shaker. He's going to go for kind of those Crystallis, Daedalus is kind of very cheesy strats. He'll be able to pick up a very quick Blink Dagger being a carry as well, which is awesome. And then you need playing just a support Morph. You know, that in its own right is childish. You can harass the lane a lot. You're quite powerful. You got a shotgun later.
I think Omnius is just confident in their skills to beat whatever draft they want.
Yeah,
I would play. Like, if I play SA top, I play fucking Earthshaker and then Dinosaur Dumpster. Because it's just confident.
Yeah, well, let's see. Let's see what's going to happen. They've definitely chosen a more cheesy strat this game. I think TSG weren't expecting it to be such a wild card. But that's fine, you know, I don't think OG would be playing this type of strat maybe against other stronger teams. I think they just afforded the opportunity now to maybe be a little more cheesy against TSG, so they've gone for it. How does Rubick do against Invoker mid? He's got Fade Bolt, which can push the lane, but I mean, does he lose?
No. I haven't seen a lot of Rubick in this, but Rubick against the Exalt Invoker, even full Exalt Invoker does more damage than Force Invoker. It's just Fade Bolts. Like, the Rubick's Fade Bolt just makes Outsider right click impossible to do, and 626 is superior at last hit to deny.
Kill the dead.
I won't be surprised if 626 kills the Outsider and uplevels him by far in this lane.
I mean, so supports traditionally kind of in the mid lane, they can obviously get skilled up a lot quicker, but they always fall off. You know, this is always the case when you play Dazzle AA Rubick mid, is that they fall off. So is there going to be a case where 626 falls off and is not able to contribute to his team later? Or is that why Unique got the Morph and they're actually pretty ready for the late game?
I think that's the best thing about Rubick, is that even for... actually fall off, because a stolen Lucent Beam is always relevant no matter how late the game goes. But that stun with the Arcane Supremacy, the dot duration is so harsh.
Spooked.
Explain.
I mean, I don't think there's anything to explain. I think Frag's pretty confident on this Viper in the lane. You know, he's got a lot of poison damage over time. Plus, you know, Maledict here on Shadow is going to be great as well. It's just first blood, you know. I guess that doesn't kind of write the whole scene just yet, Miles.
Actually getting killed by one case? What is... But,
you know what, listen, we can all die to any person on any level, I think, Miles. You know, let's bring this attitude of flaming away from you, man. I'll try to make you a better person by the end of this.
What? I'm sorry. Dota has taught me to value rank the way too much.
Okay.
I blame Dota for this. The Dota community. So, what lane? What I would like to see from Shadow is that he pulls the lane. Because as soon as if you pull the lane more and then the creep wave is under your tower, and then Spook has to come under your tower, under a Viper tower, to come get the Seer, you can easily kill him. But Shadows, he's trading with a Morphling, which is just not really smart. Rather just go pull the lane. Even if you pull the lane and it gets contested, the Morphling, who's dealing a lot of damage to your Viper, potentially, is coming to deal damage to you, taking the damage off of your carry, which is another benefit of the pull. So there's no point in you trading with the Morphling, because you're never going to out-trade him. Like, look at that, 61 damage.
Oh, look at it go!
Yeah, but I mean, this is the thing, like, it's crazy, unique. Yeah, he might just fall. He's got the Maledict on him as well with the poison damage. Should be able to guard him. Oh, wait. The man's living.
Lifting.
There's n...
Make a big mess.
Take you. Bad face. If that was a level 2 Maledict, 100% I would have killed him, but it was only level 1. It was close.
So I'll tell you exactly what happened, yeah, Miles, and I'm sure you can back me with this. Shadow did not follow up with any more right clicks. It kind of, it's that mindset of, oh, the kill is secured, I can leave. And then when it's not secured and Morph TP's back, you kick yourself because he didn't die.
Yeah, 100%.
I feel like Shadow definitely had a follow up there with more one or two right clicks just to secure that kill. And now Morph gets away and he doesn't die. And I feel like that could have easily been prevented if Shadow just committed to one or two more right clicks.
Maybe it's because of his confidence in his hero. Maybe he plays Witch Doctor a lot. I don't know, but that was definitely a mistake. You never want to just leave a kill unless you're 100%. Like, if a Morphling has 200 HP and I Laguna Blade him, like, I don't have to check that I killed him. But against the Morphling and Maledict level 1, you always have to check. Like, don't... Like, you want to take extra 3 seconds to check the kill, but if you don't get the kill, you waste a lot of resources. And then, if you do get the kill, you get a lot of money and experience, so what are you losing from it? That's the question. Not really much, just always just confirm the kill. Like, it doesn't matter how, just if it's just 3 seconds to check the kill. It's not
I think so. I think that kind of came down to very just a simple kind of add a few more extra right clicks in there so Unique did die, and that would have been it. You know, you kind of mentioned the level 1 Maledict, it's not going to do too much.
Looking at mid lane, it's 66, which is expected of him as a skill level, but it's also expected as a Rubick mid. Like, Rubick mid power spike is just level 6 where your fate falls level 3 and...
Oh, Spooked might just die bottom here, it's gonna go down. Alright, so... They are finding kills in the Muzz now, that bottom lane of TSGs.
Definitely interesting, but top lane, White Wind farming the stack made by a Sneaky Snake. I'm surprised that none of they're not contesting this. Like, Wiseman, you're not doing anything. You're just stacking this Luna's XP. Go contest the stack, or go scout for the enemies or something. This is a common mistake among a lot of pause falls that I see, is that when the creep wave is here and your Luna is under no threat, go plant a ward, go gank mid, go contest the pool or something. Don't just stand there.
Oh, no sinister gauge on Wiseman, but he does fall down, drops that frost blast on his head.
Very nice.
So I mean, things... Fade Bolt here from 6 to 6. Outsider should be able to go down here. He's going to survive.
From the clocks, very nice.
So I don't know, Miles. I almost got to ask that question right now just because of the OG draft. Do TSG have this early game because OG did a spoofy draft? Or is it one of those things like, hey, let us allow the second game to last longer so we can enjoy it? And maybe that, in a sense, is a very cheeky attitude, but what do you think we're seeing right now?
I think it's overconfidence in the... Like, Spook, he's playing the lane like a maniac. He's charging at this Viper when he has, like, 5 stacks of poison attack. Like, how it's just crazy. Like,
here we go.
And he's dead.
He's dead again.
I think it's just the overconfidence of... They're saying, oh, I can beat you with any draw, which could be a mistake. But let's see how TSG uses this.
Top lane here as well. Sinister guys onto White Wind. He's out of it, and Sneaky Snack coming around. Dez got all these abilities still. Eclipse. Oh, Vision should be able to finish him off. It's not gonna happen.
No. Oh, double kill. Nah.
Oh, and very late Sunstrike coming at you from outside. For me, I feel like the Luna's not the best carry choice. I'm not sure what TSG wanted when it came to that Luna pick, because Luna's been very phased out for a long time right now. You know, you don't see Luna carrying anymore. And even the last time I did see a Luna Secret played it as a position 4 on Yapsaw just because of Lunar Blessing. So there was an ability of Lunas that did more for them as an overall 4 position because you could get that Lunar Blessing for your attributes versus him being a core where you're not a good ganker, you're not a good pusher, you've got a very short range. Yes, you've got glaives that can spin around, but if you hit multiple targets, and maybe the Eclipse... Maybe the Eclipse is just good because it's kind of that kind of quick low cooldown ability that, you know, goes well with your Lucent Beam depending on its level, and it's got level 3 right now, which is great. But overall, it maybe doesn't mean that Luna's a good core for me. Maybe I'm giving him a 7 out of 10 right there, or a 6 out of 10 even.
But lane 66, he might die, but there was a TP coming from on this gaming bar.
Oh, the Sunstrike from 6 to 6. So he's just using outside his abilities against him. He doesn't give a damn. He might...
That Sunstrike with the Arcane Supremacy is going to do so much damage.
Yeah, of course, right? He's looking to do as much magical damage as he can. So that's actually such a brilliant hero to play against something like an Invoker, because you're going to steal magic and then amplify your magic damage.
Radiant's middle tower is under going attack. Back to the Luna, I think people need to get out of their minds that Luna is a core pick. Like, she's been a positive... Her abilities and her talents are meant to be a pass 4 or pass 5. Like, if you look at this, 400 cost range. What? At level 10, how ridiculous of a fucking level 10 talent is that? And then there's, at level 15, there's a minus 4 second Lucent Beam. Your hero's meant to play as a pass 4. I think this is why pros pick Luna as a pass 4 more, because they understand that if you play her as a core, you're wasting this power spike, you're wasting her talent as a... as a core.
So what do you think? If you do you think if you're in position 4 Luna, you go straight for the cast range and the Lucent Beam cooldown because you can throw further and it comes down sooner? Yeah. Oh, Whitewind. Able to get out there with a very quick TP.
I mean, Luna, when she has that level 15 talent and Ethan, you can satellite a guy from fucking tier 1 tower when you're on the side.
So as far as like a Mortimer's Kiss, just kind of across the whole river?
Oh, it's almost.
But I mean, I hear what you're saying, like Miles, those kind of talents really set it up. And then of course you get Lucent Beam, Radiant's damage your stats, and then lifesteal. But lifesteal only at level 25. So then your core Luna is expected to like build a satanic, you know, potentially before level 25, which is hard to do. Yeah, no, but precisely. So it's a very late game kind of core item that you have to choose. And then, of course, if you don't have a decent early game on your Luna, or you don't have stacks coming out from your team, you're not going to get a Satanic anyway. So you might just reach that 35% lifesteal before you even get the item anyway. Who knows?
Radiant's middle tower.
Yeah, we're going to have to see what TSG wanted out of this Luna. It might not have been the best pick in the world. I don't know, that's my humble opinion.
Radiant structures are fortified. I just don't like core Luna because are fortified. You're so powerful with Luna Beam, Lucent Beam. It's just you have really good movement speed because you're Luna. And
yeah, we got 6-6. He's playing on the outside. He's stolen Cold Snap as well. Should be able to freeze him and spot. He doesn't. Oh, that Fade Bolt. Fade Bolt is so dangerous. And this is like why I said like the very early game support mids are so good, because they are. So even if 6-6 does fall off now, he's already done so much damage in the early game that outside is having a bad lane. He's having a bad time. And now so he's picked up a second kill off Shadow as well, and the Maledict doesn't even kill him because I guess that debuff amp is helping him, I think. It works like that. So Radiant, you know, 6-6 is having such a fucking good game. He's top of the net worth charts. Invoker is literally very close to the bottom. And if 6-6 had a fall off now, I think it would actually be fine. OG would survive. Because inadvertently, I mean, Unique is getting big as a morph. You know, he's indirectly going to end up...
Delayed the Outsiders Invoker time by like 5 minutes. Like, he's Midas, he's normal... He was going for Midas, but now he realized that he's not.
Oh, Blood Arena getting popped with Frag and Shadow jumped in. He has a huge silence with a White one coming in from the back. He's taken down two. Gets himself a double kill. Blood Arena's down. Spooked. He should be able to get away to survive. 6-6 going here to Frag. They pick up another kill. White one takes down. Shadow, they're looking for more frags and go down. Dominating here from 6 to 6. Last man of the team is the outsider. Can he TP out? It's on cooldown. Does throw out the ice path there, but... Ah, this man's going to go down. Fade, bolt, and sneaky snake. Goodness.
I don't think I was worried about Omnius Gaming losing this game. I think... Even for the laning stage looked a bit iffy. They did die some weird times, but I think overall... They're now just Radiant's win the game. Tower
just a little attack. Iffy, you say there.
Yeah, like Spook was playing the lane like a madman. He just didn't give a fuck.
But he's still got a Sol Ring anyway. And he's still got neutral items. He's got this Ocean on. And he's calling his career. And he... Is this him with the morbid mask coming on his career as well? So, I mean, this man is Jack, dude.
I mean...
He's not even, like, stressed.
I mean, even when he died 3 times in lane and didn't get that, like, bomb... No, even before he just died 3 times in lane, he's still ahead of this Luna. He's still ahead of this Outsider. So, it's just... He just farmed better.
Well, yeah, we got Shadow's TPing in. Has a potential cost. No Death Ward just yet. So, I mean, these team fights for TSG right now are really tough without Witch Doctor having that Death Ward just to throw from the background. And into the Blood Arena as well, so it's kind of pretty great against your Muzz. But
I mean,
he's only 3/4 of the way to level 6, which he really needs to pick up right now.
Let's take a look here. This is why I don't like Luna. Luna here, because you can't take stats Radiant's by yourself. You need the whole team here, and you're still struggling. You're struggling to kill these ancient creeps.
Ah, well, Shadow bursts down the outskirts and Sneaky Snake gonna pick up that outpost yet again. A lot of neutral items dangling down here for TSG. 66 jumping with the Fade Bolt is gonna take down Visions. They're looking for more. Unique jumping in onto Frag. Meatball getting dropped yet.
The combo.
Ah, okay. That's more than likely gonna be... Oh, he's actually got Deafening Blast.
Oh, 66, no!
Chain Frost, jumping around, 66 going down, so 2 for 2 trade right now. Was there a buyback? I think it was buybacks from... No one here, actually. Unique on the other side of the tracks. Huge Echo Slam coming at you from White when they take down the outside. They're looking for more Wiseman. He's going to have to run for his life. There actually is a Fissure. Can get thrown. There we go. Unique here able to burst some. There's going to be Eclipse here coming up from the back from Visions. Able to kill anyone. White, when how are you able to get away at all? Loose some beam. Oh, mercy. He does die, though. He does die. But not to Visions and to Shadow with a Maledict. But the range on loose and beam, I think, is very far, though, isn't it, Miles? It's not bad.
Yeah, I mean...
So he could have easily got that last hit for himself and he just left it. I'm not sure why.
I mean, imagine a Shadow Shaman with the range of Lucent Beam and plus 400 cast range. That'll be the most ridiculous pass for ever.
That's actually so true, isn't it?
Like, plus 400 cast range. What kind of talent is that?
And yet they give Shadow Shaman no cast range abilities. He has to build an Etherlens. And his first ability is literally armor or damage. It's nothing to do with his abilities. It's not a longer stun duration. It's not a better Maledict. It is either one, you can take damage, or two, you can get armor. And only from level 15 do they even give him any sort of talent tree that resembles his abilities and able to do more. I hear what you're saying about that Luna. It's awfully powerful. But maybe just you're in a different kind of position, as it were. Oh, well, I mean, it is what it is. I guess, you know, people don't want to support Luna. It's just a weird concept, possibly.
But it's so fun. Like,
yeah, I'm sure it's a lot of fun.
Have you experienced the Luna Ags ulti?
I've seen it. Yeah, I know it.
That thing is broken. A Storm Spirit? He cannot zip out of it if he's caught. A Storm Spirit cannot bolt lightning out of a Luna's ulti Aghanim's if he's caught him. That's ridiculous. Radiant's bottom Considering what a Storm Spirit can't zip out of. He can zip out of Black Hole, he can zip out of X-Mar. Fucking everything, but he can't do that. Attack. That's why he's such Luna's such a good pass 4. I think I might actually play her pass 4.
There we go. Right, always find an inspiration, Miles, in any game you can watch. Kas, I mean, so, TSG with the smoke here, Miles, is there anything you want to see right now? Is there kind of some way forward for them?
Oh, if they catch 666 on command pass, listen beam. Oh my god.
Yeah, this could be it. No listen beam so far right now. He's really holding it. I don't know why.
Really holding it.
Oh, Sunstrike. He's going to miss.
Miss?
Listen, oh, they can't chase him high ground.
It was such a slow reaction time. This Witch Doctor got off his cask before this Luna got off her Lucian Beam, which shouldn't happen. Firstly, cast is harder to cast. Lucian Beam has longer range and easier.
Oh, and now Shadow might just literally get wiped by Unique. Morphus hiding around the corner. He has 66 following with a Fate Bolt. Oh, goodness. The man's gone for the count. He has Wiseman as well. Just throwing out a Sinister Gaze. It's not going to be enough. Unique picks up the kill. Sneaky Snack with those glaives. They do damage. The guy's actually got stacks on him, so look at that. That's 20 intelligence the guy's got.
Yeah, pretty good.
Oh, now Spooked. He's trolling visions, yeah.
Pretty tanky, but the vision has...
Oh boy, there's the kill. Gets himself in the Blood Arena. He's stolen the Death Ward as well from 66. Oh my goodness! Death Ward still followed up by a Fade Bolt, Miles.
That was 100% Vision's mistake. He got too greedy, and he wasn't paying close attention to his mini-map. Like, 5 heroes are missing from the map. You're their pause 1. Who are they gonna hunt? They're not gonna hunt your fucking... your pause 5 Witch Doctor, who's no threat to them. They're gonna hunt the Luna. So, like, if that happens, don't show up to a lane. But even though they did have a Sentry Ward, Obs Ward on the side of CSG Gaming, they didn't have a sentry to scout out Spook it, and who's this Luna play again? Vision just felt really confident about going into that White Wind just used his Echo's Ram to top tower is under kill attack. A creep camp.
You know what, hey, just like any way you can secure those last hits and get farm, I guess, right?
The fucking farm is important. Radiant's
top tower. Yeah, you know, who cares if you drop like an Echo Slam of 120 seconds, you know? To hell with the future team fight.
The creeps are more important, that is true.
I mean, he's got an Agnum Scepter right now, so there we go. Look at that, he jumps in, he catches Frag. We got Unique on the outside as well. Ah. Are they going to be able to catch more outside? He is here. They got the cost jumping around. The Eclipse coming out from Visions. They take down Sneaky Snake. Are they looking for more? 6-2-6 getting chased down. Oh, White Wind jumps in like a maniac, but he doesn't have the Echo Stamp. What's he going to be able to do? He takes down Frank. Is he looking for more? Sinister Gaze. Holy smokes, jumping around. What are they going to steal? It was not the Frost Plus. It actually was. It wasn't the Frost Chain, which is fine. Still jumping around. And it's 6-6. Go to Unique. Can outside kill this man. There's going to be a Meatball thrown down. Holy smokes, he should die. Double kill for Unique. Morph support, Miles. A morph support. Oh, mercy.
I mean, I've experimented with morph plus four because you just go full strength and you stun, and it's like a 3-second stun. And you can take form of this, of like a Jakiro or of a Luna. And when you get Aghanims, oh my god, you're disabled in a T5, ridiculous. Middle tower is under attack. Like, I really like unorthodox pause 4 heroes. But 66, that Essence Ring coming ready in hand. He used it twice in the team fight, and that kept him alive. And
Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
Yeah, it's giving him...
game is going...
I mean, it gives him extra intelligence with a mana regen as well, which is great. Spooked, what has he got? Still holding onto that Ocean Heart. I don't think any of these teams have really picked up a lot of neutral items right now, since it's only the 20-minute mark. Essence Ring here on the outside as well. Got a Vambrains for Visions. Dragon Scale for Viper, pretty decent on him. Philosopher's Stone here on Shadow. This can be perfect. 70 gold per minute is what he needs. And Wiseman chilling with the trusty Shovel. Oh, 100 health is 100 health, I guess you would say. Fight chain in the woods, what's going to happen? Frag, Fade Bolts. Throws out his ultimate, not going to be able to. Gets it actually stolen, turned on him as well. Goodness. The thing, 6-2-6 doesn't give a damn what he steals. He just knows he can use it against you. Meatball going to drop down to 2. Finds Wind, White Wind, and Sneaky Snake. But that's Frag down by his own ultimate.
I love Rubik Eggs. I think it's one of the top 3 Eggs. of in the whole Dota scene. Like, the ability to steal a spell in 2 seconds and then have a cooldown of 2 seconds and steal another spell, that's just ridiculous. Like, whatever this invoker can combo, this Rubick can steal the exact same spells and throw it at the exact same time.
Well, Miles, I think the most important thing about a Rubick Aghanim Scepter is that he's gonna get the Ag Scepter on every single ability he steals, though, man. So, like,
if he gets Lucent Beam, I mean, Eclipse from Vision.
So yeah, right. So exactly. So screw the cooldown. Screw all that other crap. Increase the cast range. No one cares. It upgrades the spell to Scepter level, dude. And this man has been stealing spell after spell.
Talk about Vision. Talk about the Eclipse. Let's see. How the Visions have been using his Eclipse is quite bad, because for example, he would TP here, cast Eclipse, and then run towards the enemy.
He has Spooked with the Bladder initially, able to throw it down. Chilled for now.
He is old,
man. Middle tower is under attack. They tip him, but nothing happened. Tons of tips coming out to Mars. He didn't do absolute jack. His team just with a bit of banter there, it seems.
Oh, four men. No.
He's got the blink. He's ready. Trust me, this man is very ready. Might be able to jump. They go into Vision Shadow. They get a good Fissure Block as well. Oh my goodness, they do. They catch four. In comes the huge Echo Stab from Wind White. Fuck me. Double kill, double kill, double kill. Triple kill from White Wind. Wiseman actually picks up a double kill there from his ice, his Chain Frost.
Holy shit.
But I mean, that was a 2-for-5 trade Frags bought back. 2-for-5. Huge Echo Slam inside of the Blood Arena, Miles. Like, damn.
I mean, under attack. Put more salt under the wound. There was like, it was a creep wave from TSG Gaming in the arena as well, so that Echo Slam is doing way more damage.
Oh, and a big dieback from Frag. He's now out for over a minute.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Oh, Miles, that was...
That was not what you want to say. Now, this Luna, 25 minutes, she has one Yasha, and you definitely need way more items if you want to carry as a core Luna. You need a Manta, definitely. You need a BKB, 100%. And then you need... The fuck, the Luna's even bold. I don't know, like a Butterfly or Daedalus.
Yeah, it's going to be like Manta-style BKB, dude. I mean, even to the point where, like, if you got an early Dragon Lance, is great just because you need to increase your attack range as well. So, like, very early Dragon Lance into Yasha, which builds your Manta style, and then you get a BKB. And that's, like, all Luna really gets, which is the problem, is that it makes her so weak. She's not, like, Terrorblade with huge late-game items. She's not, like, a Jug or even your Slark. Imagine, like, an Eye of Scuddy on Luna. Like, she could do it, but it seems very late for her, and she probably just would never get an Eye of Scuddy after a Manta style. Like, once you get that BKB to survive, I can't really see what else Luna's gonna get, because she wants the BKB in and then drop that Eclipse just so that she can do, like, as much magical damage and nuke damage as possible. But, oh, yeah.
I mean, itemizing for Luna 4 is really difficult, because if you buy BKB, you have no damage. If you buy Manta style, you have no survivability or any damage. But if a TP buys a BKB, he has a lot of damage because of Metamorphosis. If you buy a BKB on
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
On Slark, you have a lot of damage because that Essence Strip will just keep stacking. But Luna, I don't know, it's really hard to itemize for her.
Yeah, so I think if, like, Luna came with some form of, like, permanent gain, like your Silencer does, like your Radiance Underlord does, like your Slark does, then should be great. So if somehow, if you died under Lucent Beam or something, she picked up a 0.5 agility favorite kill, that would be great. Then should be a lot more viable, I think, like your Slarks, where, like you said, that Essence, you're going to get more agility. But she doesn't. She doesn't at all.
I mean, if Ice God made her like Luna Blessing, like a Podrus Flesh Heap, where you gain like strength, bonus strength every time you're in the vicinity, I think then Luna Core would be top way viable. Much viable in the meta. But her abilities and her talents are just meant for ganking, meant for roaming. I mean, Ice Frog baits you with the level 25, 35% lifesteal, but
yeah.
You're not going to get to that stage. I mean, how are you going to play?
Yeah,
that's
he,
the main problem.
I like that. He kind of baits you in with a very, like, far level. And he says, like, yeah, get to 25, you can have 35% lifesteal. If you have no Satanic, it's fine. But meanwhile, you have to, like, struggle the whole way to get the unique jumps, and you go straight into outside. So is White Wind as well. They should be able to bash him down. He's going to go down very quickly. Immediate buyback coming out from him. Oh, boy.
Unique just max strength, waveforms in, and then pushes Invoker outside the race.
Yep. But was it even needed from outside? I don't think he had a buyback right now. He could have waited to see what's going to happen. Now he has forced the buyback. He might just die if Unique does the same thing again.
Here we go.
Telekinesis coming out from Slattering against Throne. There's going to be huge Echo Slam coming out from White Wind. He's going to go down. That's by a dieback. In fact, White Wind, they're on the fringes. They're looking for more. Chain Frost jumping around. Shadow Shrimp to go down here. Triple kill here from Spook. They're looking for more. Oh, no.
There was so many particle effects at that place there. I think if I just started to watch Dota, I would not understand what the fuck I just saw there. Because there were so many particle effects going on. Echo Slam, Arena, Rubik's clean shit, Silence as well, and then fucking Echo Slam. Radiant's
top tower. Echo. Yeah, and of course Chain Frost coming up from Wiseman here as well as it goes down. Radiant's top barracks are
under attack. I didn't even realize that Lina's ulti was dropped.
But I mean, she dies also so quickly, I suppose, without a BKB, that, you know, it's just gonna be so tough for her to play further in this lane. The thing is, like, so right now, OG have got a perfect initiating abilities and skills to get in. Spook drops the Blood Arena, White Wind jumps in with his Agnum Scepter and immediately drops the Echo Slam. I don't even think he's got a... He has no Blink Dagger. Right, he doesn't need a blink dagger. He can jump in with his Agnum Scepter. The thing is, like, what are TSG doing to stop that onslaught coming from OG? You have to either get rid of the Muzz so that he does not drop a Blood Arena, or what are you gonna do? You're gonna have to try to get rid of the Earthshaker so that he can't jump in and drop an Echo Slam. And I don't think there's any silence on the side of TSG. I mean, there's no silence.
There's no damage on the side of TSG.
Well, yeah, but I mean, if they're all dead, they can't even do DPS, can they?
I mean, TSG, this Viper pick was good in lane, but I think Frag is making a major mistake on his itemization, because who on TSG is going to tank this damage? It was supposed to be the Viper, but he's going Monia. If I was Frag right now, if I was playing this Viper right now, even if I'm losing, I'll still go Pipe, Vladimir's, and then I'll get like a BKB or something, because they need a Pipe in this game. They need a Vlad, because it's really good with Luna, and they need just a frontline tank. But
look at Unique being so cheeky. He just turns into his Earthshake and is able to jump out with the Scepter as well. Him and White Wind, they just didn't give a shit about that meatball falling down right now. I mean, look at this. Two Earthshakers. Are you really going to play against two Earthshakers right now?
It's so much stun.
Oh my goodness, dude. Two Echo Slams, two Fishes. Here we go. Blood Arena coming out and catches two as well. He's going to be able to... here we go. First Earthshaker jumping in. Hasn't thrown his Fishes just yet. Gets a big Echo Slam. The takedown. Sneaky Snake. But, oh man. Here we go. White Wind jumping again with Unique jumping in again. Falling up as well. There's a fucking LeBron James combination. Jeez.
I don't know why all this gaming took so long. I think they were just Radiant's having fun, to be honest. I think they were just trolling. Radiant's
bottom barracks. But like, how obnoxious is this lineup of theirs, man? You've got two Earthshakers that jump in because of the Scepter. Look at this Unique. Unique's having so much fun with this morph. They're just spoofing right now. Look at this. Here we go. Double jump here into Shadow. He's going to be absolutely taken down.
There's so many stuns on the side of Omnius Gaming, it's ridiculous. Kill the dead.
Radiant's middle, but look at this potential of a morph being a position 4. He can turn onto anyone. He can turn into anyone on his team and just have so much fun. So like, now he can throw a Muzz ulti, then he can throw Actually, no, he doesn't get the ultimate, sorry. But still, he can jump in as an Earthshaker, cause trouble, or jump in as a Muzz and still cause trouble, even abate, you know, abate the fucking ultimate. Ah, it's just too much.
I mean, Rubik, I mean, Muzz basically like a Rubik, right? Radiant's
middle tower. Instead of needing one spell, you feel four, three spells middle barracks from the heroes, except for the ultimate, because that would be pretty fucking broken. So, if you have a Rubik and Muzz on your team, and you have Earthshaker, that would mean he's done so much disabled. So, double Phasia.
Oh man, well, very tough game here at the end of things for TSG. They're going to have to definitely check out the replays here, Miles. See what went wrong, see what went right. I don't know if you want to follow on the footsteps of OG's kind of very spoofy draft 2, but they really did make it work. There we go. GG is called, Miles. Game number 2 and the overall series is going to go to Omnius Gaming Origin. Oh man, so tough game there, Miles. I don't know if you just want to quickly take us through a bit of a post game here as we check out the scoreboard.
I mean, laning stage, TSG won the laning stage, except for mid lane. But Frags going for the wrong item build, firstly, and then TSG needed a tank. They got the Viper. Okay, Viper's a pretty good tank. But Frags didn't go that item mode. He didn't go the Tide, he didn't go the Vlad or the BKB. He went for Ammonia, which isn't really needed for your team right now. And of course, the Luna call, I think we ranted about the Luna call for like 30 minutes straight.
Huh. Yeah, I think we did too much there. Yeah, shame. He only went 1 for 10 as well, which was not too hectic. He didn't really get much chance, I think, to do enough in his lane.
Talk about not getting much. This outside invoker, even for it is his comfort pick, I didn't really see any impact that he made in this game. But it was really hard when you're going up against so many disables on the side of Omnius Gaming.
I think, yeah, 6-6 obviously just played a fantastic Rubik there as well. 14-1, he just was able to just knock around so much and do so much. But yeah, tough game, I think, yeah, for TSG. They did come up against a very old, experienced org that's been around the block several times, Miles. So it definitely was going to be a tougher fixture here for TSG. So any closing words?